Well, grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. I had a chance to view recently some excerpts again from the musical rock opera, Jesus Christ Superstar. How many of you ever saw Jesus Christ Superstar? Quite a few hands going up. Put out in like around 1970, 71. It was a bit controversial in its day because it really used some slang and it used kind of modern culture to interpret who Jesus was. I mean, for all intents and purposes, Jesus is a superstar. And that's what the whole rock opera was about. And it reminded me again, as that depicts the Passion Week from Palm Sunday to Easter Sunday, it reminded me again as when I was younger, how I was captivated, my heart was captured by this Holy Week experience from Palm Sunday to Easter Sunday, and the power of what God had done and what God was doing in the world and what God could do in my life. And I realized that that's right. Jesus Christ Superstar is more than, it's about more than seeing Jesus Christ as just a superstar from a distance. It's about experiencing him. It's about having your heart captured, about being captivated by him so that your life has meaning and purpose, and it changes everything. It changes what you live for. It changes how you see the world and how you see your circumstances as you live. I think that there's a temptation for us as Christians to just say, well, you know, I believe. I'm for God. I believe in Christ. And, you know, I get it intellectually, but that our heart might never be moved. That we might not really fully give our heart to the one who says to you, I'm in your corner. I'm on your side. I'm fighting for you. This is the main event. And this week is all about being grasped by Jesus, by being moved, to be moved by him, the one who is fighting for you at the main event. Well, we have a tendency as Christians to want to put Jesus in a box. It's all kind of boxes we like to squeeze Jesus in to say that, I like some of the things that Jesus said. I want to follow some of the things that Jesus said, the parts that fit my life, the way I'm living it. I like those parts of Jesus, but that's not Jesus. Jesus does, yes, it's part of him. He comforts us in our afflictions, but he also challenges us when we get a little too comfortable. And if your God isn't a God who surprises you once in a while, or challenges you once in a while, or becomes holy for you, or majestic, or mysterious for you once in a while, if your God is not a God who you say, well, he's too big for me to define, and you know, I kind of like it that way, then maybe you're missing the fullness of God. Because this Holy Week is about being captivated by the one who wants to do something to you. It's the main event. It's Jesus coming on a donkey in Jerusalem. And I don't want you to miss what God has for you. The fullness of God says, let there be light. And God created all things. And then he shows up on Holy Week, on this Easter week, as some people like to call it. But I don't want you to think that it's just a warm-up act for something greater. Don't miss it. It's what Jesus did from Passion Palm Sunday to Easter Sunday and everything in between. Don't miss it. Because if you open your mind to it, if you let your heart experience it, and let God be fully God for you, God wants to blow your mind away. When's the last time you did that? To let God challenge you. To let God surprise you. To let God be fully God for you. This is not a boxing match on the undercard. This is not some warm-up act to the big show. This is the big one. It's the Super Bowl. It's to determine who's the heavyweight champion of the world. And when we put God in a box, we can miss the fullness of who God really is when we want to simplify God to what we think he ought to be. So Jesus is coming into Jerusalem, and it's Palm Sunday, and he's coming across the Kidron Valley, and that's east, that's facing that way. And the people would have been standing here at the gates of Jerusalem, the east gate, because there's only a few places that you can get into this wall that surrounds the city to protect it from their enemies. And so they can see for miles from here. This Kidron Valley is a long, low, sweeping valley. And they would have been able to see Jesus with this entourage beginning to ride in from the Mount of Olives. And it gets crazy. People start to wave palm branches. And as they wave the palm branches, there's something going on, something more. The emperors in that day would have always depicted their images onto a coin. And that would have included palm branches with it as a symbol of royalty, as a symbol of being set apart, of being holy. And so the people see Jesus coming, and their minds are captivated, their hearts are captured, and they begin to take their cloaks and they lay them on the ground. They say, "He's the king. Let him trample on our coats." But he's riding in on a donkey, not on a war horse as King David had done, their great king of the past. As he rode into Jerusalem, there was a man by the name of Zechariah, a prophet, who said these words. He said, "Rejoice, O people of Zion. Shout in triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He's righteous and victorious, yet he is humble, riding on a donkey." Riding on a donkey's colt. And you say, "Oh, okay, I get it. Some Old Testament prophet made a prediction and Jesus fulfilled that." But there's more. In Jesus' day, the Palm Sunday events offended those around Jesus, because if the people are hailing Jesus as king, that's bad news for them. 30 years before Jesus is born, the Roman Empire hails Julius Caesar as its king. And his son, years later, Octavius, takes on the name Augustus, and he calls his father, Julius Caesar, a god, which means that I am the son of God. And he ascends the throne, and the message is everything's going to be okay because there's a divine being on the throne of the Roman Empire. And then his son, Tiberius, who reigned at the time of Jesus, took on the same name. And one would say, "Caesar is Lord." And so when Jesus comes riding into Jerusalem, into the city, and here is this carpenter on a donkey, the mighty Messiah, the pristine Nazarene who floats like a butterfly and stings, well, you get the idea. The Roman Empire says, they're calling him what? Son of God? Well, we'll have to see about that. We're going to have to do something about that. Let's see, on their side, they have a carpenter with a tax collector and a few fishermen following him down the hill. On our side, we have the whole Roman Empire and the army. This battle isn't going to be very long. At least that's what the world would say. So Jesus comes riding in, and there's expectations all around. It's the Passover week. Let's just all say Passover. Passover. Passover is a word we don't get, or we don't get enough of, we don't fully understand, or we say, "Oh, that's Old Testament, you know, we don't really need to know that." But you'd be missing an incredible part of the story. During the book of Exodus, in the early part of the Bible, God's people are oppressed by the then heavyweight champion of the world. His name is Pharaoh. And the Egyptians have them oppressed. And God has to raise up a man. And there's only one man who can actually do this. So only God can do this, because Moses grew up in Pharaoh's residence. And he grew up, you know, in a place where he would have access to Pharaoh one day. And that he would be the only one with the clout to confront Pharaoh. And one day he says to him, "Let my people go," God says. And Pharaoh says, "Moses, I'm a god. I'm your brother, but I'm a god. And haven't you seen all the things that I've been doing? Haven't you seen my kingdom? Haven't you seen all the buildings, the pyramids? Don't you see how great I am? Why do you think that I would want to go and worship your God who I can't see when everybody could see how great I am and the power that I have? Bring on your plagues. It's the Old Testament main event. And God shows up. And the people prepare as these 10 plagues take place. And on the night of the 10th plague, they prepare a meal that God tells them to prepare. It's called the Passover. God says, take your best offering. And back then, it wasn't money, it was livestock. Take the blood of that lamb and paint it on the doorpost of your home so that when the angel of death comes, he will pass over your household and you and your family will be saved, you'll be spared, you'll live. And so after that, Pharaoh says, okay, Moses, obviously your God is greater than me. Go. And Moses leads the people through the Red Sea and in the wilderness for 40 years. And eventually they come into the freedom of the promised land. And there's more to the story. But let's just say that the Passover was the main event for the people of Jewish culture at the time of Jesus. And they would gather together to celebrate this meal. And Jesus comes riding into the city on this week. He not only knows what he's doing, but he knows when he's doing it. And on that Thursday, he celebrates with his disciples the Passover meal. And it's that night where Jesus, in all of history, comes together. What he does at that meal. In just a little while, we'll share together here, you know, a little wafer and we'll dip it into wine. And you'll say, well, wait a minute, how can, you know, such a little thing be such a big deal? How can it change everything? And I would say to you, it's the most important meal you ever eat. It's where the big things become little and the little things become big because there's so much more going on. In your life, in my life, we stress out over work. We stress out over what's for lunch, over the schedules that are filled. And sometimes we come to the most important things and we just go through the motions, the main event. And you say, well, wait a minute. My life is important. I'm important. I've got my schedule full. I have all these things, important things that I have to do. Don't you know it's 2016 in Cedar Rapids and I just got a new Galaxy Samsung S7 and or an iPhone 16 or whatever is out now? I'm important. But if you're not careful, you're going to miss the main event. I'll make it Monday, Thursday maybe, or Good Friday if there's time, or probably Easter Sunday. Jesus took bread and wine, and he told his disciples, this is my body and blood. He said, it's a new covenant. He said, the old covenant, you were to remember how the angel of death was to pass over your household. He said, this is my blood that is shed for your sins and for your death and darkness. And he says that in this way, the angel of death will pass over your heart and that you'll live forever. You'll have forgiveness. It's not just a little wafer. It's the King of creation coming to you in this moment to give you forgiveness of sins, to give you new life, to put you on a new path, to give you what you can't do. And if you open your heart to it, it'll blow you away. It's about being captivated, being captured by the love of God and what he is doing for you. That's what the main event is all about. Jesus says, I'm fighting for you. I'm in your corner. I'm on your side. I am fighting a fight that you can't win on your own without me. I went to the store recently to get some light bulbs. And I don't know if you've been to the big box stores lately and been in the light bulb section. I mean, it was like two aisles and 150 shelves of light bulbs. And I'm like, there's the incandescent and the halogen and the LED and the CFL. And I mean, it's confusing. And you say, okay, I'll just take this one. And you come home and then you put it in and your wife says, that's a little too bright. Not that that would ever happen at our house. But... And then you know, you're just thinking that's kind of the way the world is with religion, right? And Christianity and the Bible. It's, you know, I'm just confused by the whole thing. And I'll just take this one. I'll just take this light bulb. And everything will be okay, right? Because it just matters that I'm spiritual. It doesn't matter which one, right? And we put God in a box. And we try to simplify everything. But God says, I have so much more. I want to come into your life. I want to live in you. I want to forgive your sins. I want to give you hope that you can't have on your own. And he says, take the blood of the Lamb. That's what John the Baptist called Jesus Christ, was the Lamb of God. Everybody just say Lamb of God. Lamb of God, that's what he said. Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Take that blood of that Lamb and place it over the doorpost of your heart and say, God, forgive my sins. Don't see the sin of my heart because of Jesus Christ. It's the main event. It's fighting the battle of sin, death, and darkness that you cannot fight on your own. But see, the disciples didn't really even understand this. They didn't really get this. They were like, let's take Rome. You know, let's get rid of Herod. Let's take over Pontius Pilate's realm. Come on now, enough of this high taxes and Roman rule. You're the Messiah. Let's go. And Jesus says, you know, with all due respect, I didn't really come here to take over a government. It's important for God's people to be involved in politics, that's for sure. And there's always a place for the children of God to play in that realm. But Jesus says, with all due respect, that's not why I came, to take over a government, as bad as it is. And so God's children are not to take over a government, as bad as it is. Jesus says, I'm not here to take over a religious establishment, or I'm not here to fulfill your expectations of what the Son of God should be. And so Judas thought, and maybe we think too, that God ought to be involved in who's elected. Maybe that's what it's all about, is a moral play or getting everything lined up just the way we want it. Sometimes we say, God, just do this thing that I want you to do. And God says, sometimes God does that. And other times God says, I have a much bigger thing for you to do. Or how about Peter? He didn't get it. He got it wrong. He denied Jesus. He was worried about what people thought of him and what would happen to him. And that's just another way we put God into a box. When we worry more about what people think of us and what will happen to us rather than what God wants us to do. But the guy I want you to concentrate on for a moment is Simon the Zealot. Now, there's a nickname. Let's just all say our name and then follow it with the Zealot for a moment, okay? I'm going to do it. One, two, three. Perry the Zealot, okay? So don't get too comfortable with that name, but at least it means you stand for something or for someone. You're not just a piece of driftwood floating along with whatever happens, right? Well, in the day of Jesus, the Zealot meant one who wanted to take over the Roman government, one who wanted to start an uprising, who wanted to be involved in a national victory. And Simon the Zealot thought that Jesus would be the one, he would be the ticket to what he could gain. And so maybe we too think that Jesus is our ticket to get whatever we want from this world. Your God's too small. You put him in a box. In the movie, the musical, the rock opera, Jesus Christ Superstar, there's a song called Simon Zelotes. He's the lead singer in the song. And it's all about people's expectation of the Messiah on Palm Sunday. And we know that Jesus came as the main event to overcome the power of sin, death, and darkness. But Simon Zelotes, Simon the Zealot, would have been upset that Jesus probably was riding in on a donkey rather than a war horse. And so in this song that I'm going to show you, Jesus stands as Simon begins to sing, to you be the power and the glory. And all the people are worshiping with him. And that's how we're created, to worship God. God's put a worship in our heart. But notice what happens when Simon adds, and add just a little touch of hate for Rome. Notice the smile leave Jesus' face and the growing disappointment. Take a look.
Yeah.
Jesus' heart is broken because Simon misses the point. Jesus is here not to conquer Rome, but to conquer the power of sin, death, and darkness. Bring forgiveness and life forever. But you think, well, maybe that's not as big a deal as conquering Rome. But then let me ask you this and have you think about this. What's your long-term plan for overcoming death in this world? What's your plan for ridding yourself of sin, erasing sin in your life, the guilt and shame, and overcoming death without Jesus? I'm not talking about living a long life and being healthy. You know, the Bible would be in favor of that. People, you know, should take care of their bodies, the Bible says. But I'm talking about no matter how healthy you are, one day you will die. And what's your plan for overcoming death? It's the main event. Open your heart to it, even if intellectually you're not fully comprehending it today. Open your mind and open your heart to Jesus says, "Who I'm on your side, I'm in your corner, I'm fighting the fight for you." Just as the great old hymn, "A Mighty Fortress," said, "And now a champion comes to fight whom God himself elected." Jesus is fighting the big dogs. That's why he had to go to a cross. That's why he had to die a death in order to win a victory over it. That's why he poured out his blood for you. It's why he gives you the promise of a Passover wine today to celebrate with him, because he says, "I love you. And I want you to open your heart to it and experience it." It, with all due respect to other religions in the world and all other important things in our life, not one of them can do that. They can maybe give you great moral behavior or give you the opportunity to have a passionate life or maybe even add to good government, but there's more to Holy Week. Even if you don't get it fully intellectually, give your heart to it. To be filled with the Holy Spirit, the Bible says, simply means to know how much you're loved by God. Ephesians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul says this, that you may, he's praying that you may have the Spirit in you to know how high, how long, how wide, and how deep God's love is for you. So let this Holy Week be a time when your heart is captivated, when your heart is captured by God, that you might be willing to have God's blood poured out for you, poured into you, because God loves you. God loves you. God loves you. And his proof is in the cross of Jesus Christ, the main event. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for bringing your word, your power of your presence into our lives today. As we wave our palm branches and sing your praises, God, may our love rise to you as a result of the love that you have first given us. May our hearts go to you, O God, that we might not miss what's going on and what you want to share with us this week. God, do something deep in us that responds to your love and grace today. As we experience the presence of your Son Jesus in the bread and the wine today, let that power wash over us. Cleanse us. Let it paint the doorposts of our heart, God, that you may only see the love of Jesus Christ. To him be the glory. In his name we pray. Amen.